Luxriot Evo Global has two dedicated applications, so two interfaces to access the Evo server core. One of them is Evo Console, which you're currently seeing. This is a dedicated interface for administrators, and it is aimed at system configuration. So you have all the servers, all the channels and devices and maps and layouts and video walls and other resources. As well as access control, so connected external services for facial recognition and other things. And then there is a separate section for the configuration of automated scenarios. So for example, we have a couple of scenarios configured right here. So pop-up camera on screen based on facial recognitions, and generate alarms, so generate bookmarks based on facial recognition. And then the console also has a section for live system monitoring, the health monitoring, where the administrator can quickly see what's going on wrong with the system, if the streams are down or if the servers are down. And then, of course, there is the audit section, which contains the audit log from the point of view of the server. So important server events like in configuration, synchronization. And then there is a separate section for user events. So whenever a user exercises their permission to do something, to access something or to change something in the system, a corresponding entry appears here in the audit log, which can be, by the way, also recorded into a separate database. So whenever the user tried to log in successfully or unsuccessfully, there is a corresponding item appearing here with the connection details. So the second interface, the second application, is called Evo Monitor, and it is the operator's interface. It doesn't have any capabilities for changing the system configuration, so hence it is foolproof, and also it doesn't contain any unnecessary things which helps operator to focus their attention on what's important to them. So the idea of the Evo Monitor application is that it has several tabs here on top to switch between the different kinds of investigation modes. Then there is the resources section on the left, from where we can select different cameras to drag and drop them onto the viewing area. And then here in the right part, there is the main application menu that allows you to tweak the application, change the appearance, assign hotkeys, etc., etc. And then there is the alarm panel that allows you to view the recent alarms and handle the alarms, escalate them, close them, change the alarm the severity level, etc., etc. So from here, it's also possible to pop up a certain camera, or whether in a live view or in the instant playback. So instant playback is another exciting feature available in the live view, which allows the operator to play back the last 5 minutes or 10 minutes of the footage, so without losing the live view for all other cameras currently being presented. So from here, it's possible to quickly review the timeline, replay the incident, and then from here, maybe put an additional bookmark on this incident, export the snapshot, export the whole video with a single click, goes directly to the library, and then it's also possible to switch to the fully featured playback from here. So the regular fully featured playback is also available in multi-channel mode. So for all channels which are currently present in the layout, they are played back synchronously. So they are synchronized to the second. Instead of playing the archive back on the top speed, the operator can also use the timeline thumbnails just simply by hovering the mouse over the timeline. Then below the timeline, there are also controls For manipulating the archive or browsing the archive, so jump frame by frame or jump by hours, by minutes, jump here and there, and then it's also possible to change the playback speed, so to play playback the archive on top speed in either direction. Then it's also possible to jump by events. So in case the camera has motion events, it's also possible to jump by motion events. So all the tools which facilitate the operator's effective work, including the simple but very efficient go to a specific time button that looks like a little clock here, so where I can specify the date and time and quickly jump to that moment in time and then review the footage, the play or the footage synchronously. From here, it's also possible to create snapshots, multi-channel snapshots, and export videos. So that is, this one is a traditional playback. On top of it, there are certain tools that also help the operator to browse the archive. First of all, there is the archive calendar. So with the blue, we have the marked the periods when the recordings are present for all or for some of the cameras currently present in the layout. Then the operator can also browse the archive based on the bookmarks in case these were created in the system. So quickly jump to a very specific moment in time. And also from here, they can add another bookmark for another specific moment in time just for further reference. Then the third one here is also to browse the archive based on analytics events, where it's possible to search for a specific event or a specific video analytics object or class. On top of the traditional playback mode, there are also several modes that allow quicker archive investigation. So first of all, there is the smart search, which is motion-based. You select the camera, you select the period of interest and the distance in seconds between consecutive motion events, and then there you go. And then you can play back. You can change the grid in here and play back and see what has been happening here. So this interface here, the video interface here, is exactly similar to the instant playback. So all the controls are exactly the same. And the second one, my favorite, is sequencing. So in this mode allows searching for events in a very large period of time without any analytics enabled for that particular camera. So we don't need nor motion, neither analytics events in order to find an incident here quickly. So let me show what I mean. I select the camera, I select a longer period of time. So for example, here, I know that the camera was moved and I need to find when it was moved. So let me define the time period and make a sequence out of it. So the footage is split into a series of scenes, allowing it for the operator to see very quickly, just with his eyes, where the changes took effect. So this comes very helpful for incident browsing. So for example, if there was an accident, a car accident on a parking lot, and the operator will see the difference where the car was hit and where it wasn't hit. And this process can be repeated iteratively, so a new sequence created by selecting a start point in time and then the end point, and select the new, making a new sequence until the operator finds what he's looking for. So down to 2 minutes. When we arrived to those 2 minutes, we can switch to fully featured playback. And here, playback, and maybe on a higher speed. So you can notice that it took me like less than a minute, maybe even less than half a minute, to find this particular moment in time I was searching for. So that's sequencing. That's called sequencing. Then on top of that, we have not only video, so hence Evo Global not just is not just a video management platform, but it's a data management platform. So we have other kinds of resources here. So we have text. We have textual data from data sources, and the text overlays the video, and there may be some also keywords with certain reactions to those keywords. And then it's also possible to browse through that text by selecting a camera and selecting the period of time of interest and a specific text you want to search for. So in this case here, it's a point of sale terminal, but it can be also other textual sources like ATMs. And so it's possible to search and probably stop the search when you're content with the results, double click any item to see the whole transaction, and then it's also possible to export the video with the text embedded into it and synchronized with the video. Also the tab panel here on top includes more tabs depending on the available integrations. They will appear here. So in this case, we have facial recognition, license plate recognition here, but it will also contain access control. So once the remote access control is connected, so for example, what's in here for facial recognition? So we can search. Also, we can search based on a camera, based on some picture. So select this one or select that one, then mark the face of interest, right? And then search in a specified period of time. So if I want to see if this person has visited the building, has visited the branch during a certain period of time, I can do that very quickly by just using his image provided by some third-party source. And so in here, I can browse those recognition events, and I can also export a report in a PDF format, in Excel format, or in a comma separated value format. So these reports are available in the library, and you can double click them to make them open. So that's a report, and you will see a comparison between the detected face and the enrolled face. And you'll also see a bunch of estimators, because the facial recognition engine doesn't simply provide the facial detections and recognitions with the database, but it also includes a set of estimators. So based on those estimators, we can build different interesting reports. For example, see what was the gender distribution in the branches, or what was the age distribution of customers in the branches, etc., etc. So in addition similarly to those face recognition reports, there are also reports based on the video analytics counters. So we have a setup of with the video analytics here. So actually, you can see this pink vertical line here. It does the person counting, visitor counting, and there is also a counter here in the bottom left corner of the video. So this counter, let me just use it to build some kind of report for these 2 days to see how many visitors were. So in this way, I can identify the peak hours in each of my offices or branches.